Okay, good morning, everybody. So today our guest is Leonid Dubrovinsky. Leonid is working as a professor in the Bayreuth University, as you may know. He also is at the position of Akademischer Director, which means he runs his own projects. And there are four positions like that, as I learned from Leonid. So he's one of the four directors. His diploma and PhD were from Moscow State University, very reputable kind of university in the best probably in Russia. And without much further ado, I would like Leonid to invite and give his talk.
So, I have been told that I have switch on this device. Good still morning, everybody, even if it's day in Germany, but I still feel full of energy. Thank you, Victor, for invitation and for kind introduction, and colleagues for fruitful discussions, which I'm looking forward to continue after this talk. So I'm going to talk today about the high pressure, high temperature, single crystal structural studies at multi-megabar pressures. Well, pressure can be used for many different way and application, for producing the pill drugs, for example, or making the grape juice, which can be eventually made with wine. But all these applications are not really close to my soul. I was much more interested to use the high pressure for study fundamental physics, like the high pressure induced superconductivity in the materials, or study of the state of the matter at the extremely high pressures, high temperatures, for example, warm, dense matter, or investigation of a new chemistry of matter, for example, synthesis of unusual hydrides or complex oxides with unusual properties, or resolving the fundamental geophysical, geochemical problems like interaction of deep melt with surrounding materials, or origin of diamonds on surface of our planets and the inclusions in these diamonds. If you look on all these things together, we are looking for high pressure physics, chemistry, properties, and structure relations. And the ground to investigate all of these different directions, different aspects of matter and high pressure is, of course, the crystallography, or be more precise, diffraction or X-ray crystallography. Of course, it's great pleasure, honor to speak about the high pressure crystallography and geophysical lab in the place where, to a certain extent, X-ray crystallography, especially in application to mineral physics, started by Weisskopf, where worked such people as Charles Pruitt, Larry Finger. Bob is here. So Bob Hazen. Okay, so I could talk about the acting classic of our field. So this is quite an interesting opportunity to present what directions we are going now. Of course, I don't need also in this auditorium to explain the principle of a diamond anvil cell technique, because it also was to a significant extent born here. Just to mention that the technique is developing with the event of toroidal anvils, which recently reported to achieve pressure over 600 GPa, with the technique which we are developing, a methodology we are developing with a double stage diamond anvil cell, where we seems to be break the 1 terapascal static pressure, we can do much more in terms of the compression. Just to illustrate this, one or a couple of figures which shows the our experiment, recent experiment on the hydrogen. Well, we could not use the iPhone to make a nice photograph, so we developed a simple setup to look inside the cell under very high pressures. And we don't know how to measure pressure with the turn of the screws, so we measure pressure with the gold in the chamber. So this is a reflection and transmission photographs of hydrogen at 480, 540, and 570 GPa. And we make a conclusion for at least until 570 GPa. Hydrogen is still at least partially transparent and not reflecting. What we see reflecting here is a piece of gold used as an internal pressure standard. So we can generate with a diamond unveiled cell or some kind of modification diamond unveiled cell very high pressures. But until very recently, the limit of the high pressure single crystal studies was set on around 15 GPa. 15 GPa, any liquids which we know solidify. And when we solidify in diamond anvil cell, which is a uniaxial stress device, the stresses are tends to destroy the crystal. So everybody, including myself, believe that it would be not possible to do ever single crystal diffraction studies in diamond anvil cell at really high pressure. But development of the methodology of gas loading of a diamond cell, especially gas loading with soft inert gases like helium or neon, brought into play the, another opportunity, namely to check if in these gases the crystals can survive. And several groups, including ours, in the middle of last decade, starts to experiment with such options, and particularly in one of our first experiments in 2007-2008 on the gamma boron, we realized that we can compress the crystal of boron to over 70 GPa and still get the decent structural data. So it's not enough just to have the significantly high pressure. If you want to do single crystal diffraction, we should have a large opening of the diamond anvil cell as soon as we want to cover a significant portion of a reciprocal space. The great contribution was done by one of the pioneers of our field, Reini Buller, who introduced the diamonds with the conical seats. We later a little bit modified this construction or this design by introducing the spherical seats, but in principle it is the same idea. And now one can buy such diamonds commercially for many different sources. We also need the special cells which will support such type of seats and diamonds. We, in most of our studies, using the so-called BX90, BX90 and BX90 mini cells designed and developed by Innocenti Kantor, our PhD student. We also, this cell is called BX90. It theoretically should provide the opening 90 degree. In fact, in the reality, we hardly can reach 78 degrees, or plus minus 38. So we're trying to develop some modifications, particularly we call it BX110. Maybe we can call it even 120, because it's designed for 120. But at the moment, it works up to 105 degree. It already have been tested. And we notice that even with such opening, such options to rotate, to cover reciprocal space, we can do many interesting things, including to looking for the hydrogen bonds or hydrogen bonding in the different compound. So if you have the sample or crystal in the cell, if you have the appropriate cell, and if you have a diffractometer, idea how to collect data is very simple. Just put it on the center of a rotation and collect the frames. This is an obvious idea. This is, for me, some kind of a historical movie made when we still worked in Sweden, in Uppsala. And it's supposed to illustrate how we think about further development of the technique. In reality, it took a lot of effort and dedication by our colleagues at different synchrotron facility to really achieve this goal, single crystal data collection in diamond anvil cell. And I would like to mention, of course, Prenjik Dera and Vitaly Prokopenko at APS, Michael Hoffland and Marco Merlini at ESRF. Without their help and their actual contribution, all what I'm going to talk today would not be even possible. Okay, this is about the principle of data collection in the diamond anvil cell for single crystal at ambient temperature. If you want to go to the high temperature, we should somehow heat samples, and the natural way is to heat it with a laser. You have many type of laser heating setup here at synchrotrons. All of them are, to a certain extent, stational. You cannot rotate, just rotate the cell, because you will lose immediately alignment. And you cannot move such a table if you want to collect data during the laser heating. So we work on the development of a portable laser heating setup, which is, in fact, include the all usual components, the source of laser light, illumination, observational, spectroscopic parts. But everything what we what you see here was inserted in the industrially produced the so-called laser heating heads made by German firm Precitec. Of course, they did it not for us. This is some kind of a modification of a standard equipment used in the car or aerospace industry, but they agreed to work with us to adjust and modify it for our needs. So what you can see here is a photograph from one of our first experiments on ID9 with the two laser heating heads mounted in the rectangular geometry with graphite mirrors directing the laser light to the cell, also sitting on the same stage. All this plate is mounted on the goniometer stage. And during the laser heating, we can rotate cell and collect the data. Similar setup was tested, developed and tested NID 27 beamline at ESRF, and then at PO2 beamline at Petram 3. When the visibility of such type of experiments was demonstrated, we were lucky to get support from the German Federal Ministry of Science and Education, and made a specialized setup for Petra 3 PO22 beamline. This is a piece of engineering art made by our postdoc and students. And here you can see the short movie collected during the commissioning of the system. You see the laser spot, hitting laser spot, while the whole system rotated plus minus 35 degrees. No fluctuation in the intensity, no fluctuation in the position of the beam. Everything is stable and working. So that's how it's supposed to look like. It's not always like this, but in principle, it may function. Just to get you some flavor what we can do with this type of a setup, one example of a high pressure form of iron nitride collected at ambient temperature and during the heating. We not only clearly see from single crystal diffraction data increase in the unit cell volume due to thermal expansion, we also can make the structural refinement, including the in this case, anisotropic thermal parameters, and see how the atom become, how to say, larger due to thermal vibration. So this is actually, I believe, a clear illustration where the system is working, and we can get the sensible data. So how we are processing the result? What you can see here is a data set, hemisphere collected and in-house microdiffractometer for material or cleaner pyroxene treated in the diamond anvil cell, then extracted and placed for the data collection on the goniometer head. You can immediately see in the Crystallis Pro Evelsphere Explorer rows of spots which allow you immediately assign the lattice parameter, and even if you have several domains, it's how to say, standard work. It's everyday life of a crystallographer to analyze such type of a data. There is no problem. Everybody can do this. What you can see here, this is a data set collected in the diamond anvil cell after laser heating. You can immediately notice that part of a sampled reciprocal space is quite slim. You don't have much reflections as you would like to have. You have a lot of dust due to, not only due to pressure medium, in this case neon, but also contribution from the diamonds, or even worse, what you can see now marked by green, oversaturated spot on the detector due to diamonds. So you have to mark all of them, then we can remove them, and then start to look carefully again into the reciprocal space, trying to find the lines or rows of the reflections. If you do it sufficiently long and carefully, you can indeed find that there are some kind of lines. So now it's marked, one of the main marked by blue. Second should appear now, yes, which I marked by red. You can remove all the other reflections and see what, yeah, you indeed have at least two reasonable domains which you can analyze and integrate. The interesting point here, what everything what you can just have seen here is from the sample which was compressed to 193 GPa. It was a rhenium in the neon pressure medium and heated to 3,700 approximately degree K when quenched to ambient temperature. So as a result of the heating material, rhenium reacted with diamonds. We got the, after analyzing and solving the structure and its refinement, we got the composition rhenium-2C compound, monoclinic with 187 independent reflections, with R-int slightly above 2%, with refinement to R1 6.6%, and we got the crystal structure. So it is, again, illustration that we can extend all this type of business to pressure range around 200 GPa. One important for me comment. If everybody can do such type of analysis. Initially, we started this with just two people, Елена Быкова and Максим Быков. And I was for some time convinced that this is really very hard. We start to look around to find the way to how to say, automatize the approach, to just search for all these domains by automatic software. In fact, we found the group in Copenhagen University, who Professor Hoening, who developed algorithm, and we are now working on the software which is supposed to do all of these things in the more or less algorithmic way. I believe that it's only way, but the time passed and development is very slow. There are many crudles on this way. In meantime, I got another PhD students. And over last 2 years, I have 3 more students which can do it on the same quality like Maxim and Yelena Bykova. 3 others doing it sufficiently good, and 2 has a problem. In other words, what I wanted to say, that almost everybody can do this. You cannot make from every regular person Formula One pilot, yes? But everybody can drive the car, or almost everybody. This is approximately the same situation. So I believe it's just a question of training and dedication. Now, one important technical thing when we're talking about the multi-megabar pressures. We also need the specific setups and specific beam lines. This is iron oxide heated at 205 GPa. And if you, what you can see here is and collected at ID15 beamline at ESRF. ID15 beamline at ESRF, you may know it is one of the high pressure beamline. It's considered as a specialized high pressure beamline. So what you can see here is basically a rhenium gasket and probably a couple of spots. These are from neon. This is probably from the sample. That's all. The same sample collected at ID11 ESRF beamline, which is now considered as a nano-focusing beamline. You still have a lot of rhenium. Beam size here 10 micron, here is 0.4 micron, but you can immediately recognize the diffraction from the some kind of a crystallite. This is a still image, so it's obviously not just a collection of several angles, it's just one angle, so you have a spotty line. And if we really collect and analyze this, we can find the new structure of AFO. I will mention this in a few minutes, a little bit more about this. So I need also good beam line and special environment. Now, couple of a scientific illustration to what, for what we can use this type of approach. Now I'm going to talk about the new energetic materials, about the search of search of life on the other planets and the exotic state of the matter. And I would like to start from the oxygen and the life. Everybody, first year geological students, I believe, like the principle which we call uniformitarianism. Sorry, it's very difficult for me to pronounce this word because in Russian literature, it's just called the principle of actualism. It means that everything which you observe now on the our planet should happen on our planet before and may happen in the future. Moreover, we can even a little bit generalize this principle and say that everywhere in the universe, if you have similar conditions and similar compositions of the planetary body, you should observe the same type of processes. We have obvious oxygen cycle on our planet which support the life. Question if is a how it's this cycle was started and developed. And of course, when we are talking about the something which is responsible for oxygen cycle, we need some element which change the oxidation state. The only abundant element on the Earth which is, has a variable oxidation state is iron. So, that is one of the, how to say, bold reason why we start to look for behavior of iron oxide at high pressures, high temperatures. At ambient conditions from the chemistry book, we know three different oxides. FeO, Fe3O4, Fe2O3. FeO made of Fe0O6 octahedra. Other two faces, at least at moderate pressure, also include the iron trigonal prism. Of course, we can imagine many different arrangements between the octahedra and prism. We also even construct some kind of a gammological series of such type of oxide. And indeed, a number of them have been synthesized by our group and colleague. I can even say many of them can be quenched to ambient conditions, for example, Fe4O5. And they demonstrate a very interesting physical and magnetic properties. We have correlated with their structural transformation, particularly formation of incommensurate structures at different pressures and temperatures. But this is out of the subject of my today's talk, so I just mentioned this. In basically any of our current experiments on the AFEO system, we are getting new and new phases like monoclinic FeO at 77 GPa or thorombic phase, which I already mentioned at 205 GPa, or another hexagonal phase at 235 GPa, which is, by the way, not a B1 or B2 structured, and suggest that the phase diagram of AFeO at 2 megabar pressure range have to be reconsidered. We see the same with another compositions, for example, orthorhombic Fe3O4 phase at 66 GPa, or another monoclinic in 78 GPa, which also gives us interesting hint that at megabar pressure range, not only octahedra and trigonal prism are building block of FeO system, or some new phases which have been found studying product of FeOOH decomposition also at different pressures. So there's a quite rich and interesting crystal chemistry. But most unusual result, which I believe we found in this system, was on the heating of just Fe2O3 at significantly high pressures between, let's say, 65 and 100 GPa, and temperatures on the order of 2,500 K. We found the clear evidences with post-perovskite structured Fe2O3 starts to decompose, first increasing, let's say, volume after heating, and then eventually transformed to another phase with obviously reduced iron. So who can reduce iron in this reaction? It looks like nobody apart of the oxygen. So that's how we interpret initially this observation, just simple reaction. We do not see the pure oxygen just because diffraction is obviously too weak, but we can imagine that if something changes in the chemistry, it should be some kind of release of the oxygen. Well, let us see if it's only a possible explanation. The question, if it's only possible explanation, came after Dave Mao and co-authors reported the synthesis of FeO2, which was described as a pyrite structured iron oxide with two wavelength Fe2 plus forming this compound upon heating of the iron or iron oxides in the excess of the oxygen. So we indeed can reproduce synthesis of this material. We got the single crystal diffraction data. We confirm what it is cubic and have a symmetry PRA3 bar, but what we found significantly different is shortest oxygen-oxygen distance, which is at pressure around 70 GPa is 2.14 angstrom. If we can, we may compare this with the classical peroxides, for example, with MgO2 at 0 GPa, which indeed has a pyrite-type structure and has a distance 1.49 angstrom. It's hard to imagine that the compression of peroxide will lead to increase the oxygen-oxygen distance, which force us to think that this material is not a peroxide containing O2 to minus groups, but instead it's probably high pressure PDF2 type structure. But even when we assign the type of a structure, it doesn't tell us what is the valence or charge of a cation or state of anions. So we can imagine different options. Fe2, Fe3, Fe4, or 2 minus, or 2 minus 2 minus, or 2, 3 minus, like, for example, group by Chomsky proposed, or maybe something else. Mössbauer spectroscopy, synchrotron Mössbauer spectroscopy in the energy domain, and ID18 can help us to answer the question. This is a Mössbauer spectra of product of reaction between iron and oxygen at 58 GPa. We can clearly see the non-reacted material HCP iron, orange singlet. We see the partially oxidized Fe25 or 32 phase was by blue 68, and we see the green singlet, so it's only one position of iron, which is a good, which corresponds to FeO2. Hyperfine parameters of this singlet corresponds almost exactly, basically can I say exactly, to what we expect for iron 3+. So this is, for us, the significant evidence that iron has oxidation state plus 3 in FeO2. Now, if you look on the compressibility of FeO2, we find that it's unusually high. The green triangles are from the work by Hu et al, and black squares are from our data. Agreement is pretty good, keeping in mind that this is a powder diffraction, this is single crystal diffraction data, this is synthesized from Fe2O3, this is synthesized by direct reaction iron and oxygen. I would say that this is a very good agreement. But bulk modulus is really very high. It's much higher than we even can expect in Fe2O3 at this direction. Moreover, if you do some simple crystal chemical exercise and put the different known volumes of Fe06 octahedra at different compounds at high and low spin state, we see that these stars, which are from our FeO2 data, are significantly low, so octahedra is much smaller. So something is not compatible directly with assumption that it's just Fe3+ and normal, how to say, oxygen. We can reconcile all these observations if you assume that instead of O2 minus, we have O minus 1.5. Calculations performed by our colleagues and friends from Linköping University, group by Professor Abrikosov, actually confirm our hypothesis, and they found that indeed, this is comparison just for magnesium oxide. So we found for FeO2 at pressures at least up to 150 GPa, oxygen doesn't form the bonds and should be considered as the species having the charge minus 1.5. So, does it have any implication, does it, some importance for the Earth sciences, planetary sciences? Well, I have a significant reservations to talk about the FeO2 or FeO2H as an important component of Earth or planetary lower mantle or even lower mostal mantle. So, but let us see if oxygen can have a different oxidation state in the major component of the Earth's mantle, for example, in the perovskite or post-perovskite. For a long time, we tried to find the or to analyze the crystal chemistry of iron 3+ and in the silicate perovskite. We found that whatever we are doing, the iron is still sitting in the A site, even with a very high amount of iron incorporated in the structure, and it's remained as iron 3+. We did the same for the different silicate perovskite with different compositions. We found that its material is stable to through whole lower mantle range. We even found that we can synthesize the pure iron silicate perovskite with a deficient A position, but still there is no reason to put iron 3+ in the B site. It's all sitting in the A site for the perovskite. So let's look what will happen when we go to much higher pressure and transform into post-perovskite. This is a crystal which we, one of the first crystals which we studied at this pressure range. So we can immediately see transformation from perovskite to post-perovskite. We can collect the decent data set. We can refine it. This is what we had before heating, and this is what we had after heating. And please look here. If you even assume that all this iron is 3+, you cannot make the charge balance. It can be possible only if the oxygen is partially has the oxidation state below -2, I mean above -2. So not -2, but -1 point something. So this is an interesting indication. Moreover, we recovered the sample, we investigated with a TEM analysis, and we found direct evidence of the redox reaction by presence of, the Fe3O4 particle in the recovered material, which means that we started from the fully oxidized iron and came out back with a partially reduced one. Okay, we can do also one of the classical crystal chemical type of analysis, just putting the polyhedral volume for A and B as a function of unit cell volume for different compositions. And we see that, yes, indeed, in the post-perovskite state, we have some deviation from the linear behavior, indicating that crystal chemistry changed slightly. So we believe that the oxygen -1.5 can have influence on the behavior of silicate perovskite at high pressure. As a result, it may be very interesting consequence from what we are looking more generally for the oxygen cycle in the on the our planet, and maybe not only on our planet. What we can clearly, what we hypothesized a couple of years ago, that recycling of band iron formation could result in the appearance of the source of oxygen inside the mantle. It was a recent publication by Denis Andreau, very nice paper in the Geochemical Letters, where he basically, even the pictures are somehow similar, supports this idea, but on base of a completely different argument. In fact, we know that the oxygen level on our planet changed drastically over the whole geological history. It was several periods of mass extinction, and surprisingly, we are very close, or maybe coincide in the time with the high oxygen content in the atmosphere. For us, it means that for now, we consider it the greenhouse effects, human activity as very important for the affecting environment. Maybe there are more fundamental things happen on our planet, which can result in the much more significant and drastic changes. We should not forget that our planet is a very dynamic and can produce or bring some components, including the oxygen from the deep interior on into the surface. And in fact, it may be that other planets which has a similar type of recycling can also produce the oxygen on the absolutely natural way, not necessarily depending on the appearance of the life. Okay, this was about the first case, oxygen and life. Second case is a silicon, on which I want to demonstrate some, from my point of view, exotic state of the matter. And even more precisely, I'm going to talk about the behavior of the kaolinite under compression. Kaolinite was first synthesized in 1953 by Lorin Coes at pressure 2 to 3 GPa, which we currently even sometimes not consider it as a high pressure, just starting. But this synthesis, as I believe and what I read in the literature, it was 10 years before me, so I cannot remember this, actually rocked the geological community because it demonstrated that all minerals, all materials which we see around us, including the simple quartz, at very moderate conditions can transform to something else. There is also even opinion that synthesis of a kaolinite and its later discovery in the discovery of kaolinite and stishovite in the Arizona meteor crater were give the birth of a modern mineral physics or high pressure mineral physics as we know it by now. So this is very important material. Which have been found in many rocks coming from the depths up to 200 kilometers. But it's no surprise that a lot of studies were dedicated to investigation behavior of the different silica polymorph, including kaolinite at high pressure. One of such nice work was published in 1998 and report the amortization of the kaolinite upper compression at pressure 25 to 35 GPa. Everybody, including our group, believe that this would actually happen, but still we wanted to see if something strange may occur before the amorphization. Well, we loaded the kaolinite in diamond anvil cell. At you see the pattern at 5.7 GPa. This is a so-called wide rotational pattern when we have a cell rotated plus minus 20 degree and look what's come onto a detector. All bright spots are from diamonds, all weak ones are from crystal of the kaolinite. Nice crystal, what can I say? This is 37.5 GPa, still diamond, pressure transmitting medium neon, but you still can see diffraction from some kind of crystalline phase from which come from the kaolinite. Even when we compress the material to pressure almost 80 GPa, we still see the spots from something crystalline inside the diamond anvil cell. So in the sufficiently soft pressure transmitting medium, there is no, at least full amorphization of the kaolinite. We managed to collect diffraction data and solve the structure at 21 GPa. It's still kaolinite 1. At 27, it's another phase with a slightly lower symmetry P21 over C, but still consisting of the tetrahedra, little bit different rotation between tetrahedra. Interesting event happened at around 40 GPa, when we got a completely new structure. And as you can see, it consists of three different type of polyhedra. Tetrahedra, like in the kaolinite, octahedra, like investitiavite, and five coordinated silica. Search for silica phase with a five coordinated silicon lasts for decades, where many theoretical predictions existence of a phase which consists contains the five coordination silicon in the silica. Okay, I think this is a, at least for as far as I know, was first such a finding. Not a pure S five coordinated silicon, but at least part of the atoms are obviously coordinated by five oxygen, forming, depending on your taste, either distorted square pyramid or trigonal B pyramid. We also can clearly see the fragments of the almost close packed oxygen atoms with silicon occupying the octahedra. But what is most interesting are this type of a connection between the octahedra. As you can see, we have octahedra with a shared faces. This is something which we obviously did not ever expect to see. In 1929, Pauling introduced the five rules, five crystallochemical rules. In 1954, for these rules and some other discoveries in the theory of chemical bonding, he got the Nobel Prize. Four of his rules, okay, were found a lot of exception, even by the time when he got the Nobel Prize. But his third rule was considered as the, at least for highly charged small cations, as the very, very strict and serious. But there are no possibility for two highly charged cations form the polyhedra with a relatively low coordination number sharing the faces. As far as I know, this is actually first case when we really have such a material. Well, we have to be careful. Pauling was a very smart person. He formulated the rule that stable faces should not have shared faces. This is obviously metastable phase, which confirmed by theoretical calculations. Here are energy level for the alpha PbO2 and calcium chloride type structures of SiO2, and you can see we have a half electron volts towards the coesite 5. In fact, this is very interesting observation by itself, because the difference in the energy is so huge that if one tried to make the prediction of this phase, he gets the tens of thousands different structures in the, this energetical gap. Why repeatedly in the several experiments we always getting the same coesite 5 structure, we don't know. Whether something which is governing the transformation in this direction, and it's most probably not just energetical path. Well, and one more in, observation which is related in this to this phase. We all know that structure of the liquids, and particularly or glasses, for example, SiO2 glasses, could be well reproduced by structure of the subsolidus phase. For example, if you assume SiO2 glass at ambient conditions or low pressure, and compare it with compare its partial part distribution function with the part distribution function of quartz or coesite 1 or cristobalite, we can see that cristobalite 1 is or cristobalite is nicely reproduced the PDF of SiO2 glass. So this is fine. This is known. We also know that at high pressure, the structures of glasses are changes significantly. There's a hot debate how it's going, through the five-coordinated silica, or mixture of a four- and five-coordinated silica, or just directly to six-coordinated silica. Well, if here is a PDF experimentally measured by Clemens pressure at 57 GPa. And here are PDF for different phases. Calcium chloride type, green one, that's quite different. For cristobalite X1, it's also have a significant difference. And for chiasoid 5, it's almost coincide. Okay, I cannot say that we have the structure of the glass, but I think with this coincidence of the PDF of the glass and chiasoid 5, telling us that the major features of organization of this material are similar. So we have silicon in 4, 5, and 6 coordination, and that probably there is even connection between the octahedra in the silica glass. Okay, two more comments in this scientific case. 5-coordinated silica. So far, we considered it as very exotic state. But when we start to look more carefully in the behavior of different silicates, and I given the only example of this material, danborite, which we studied with Anya Pakhomova, we found that, well, it's not so difficult to make the materials with the 5-coordinated silica if we metastably compress this framework silicates to high pressure. So this probably opened for us a way to produce the early inaccessible states of the meta by just room temperature compression in the hydrostatic or quasi-hydrostatic conditions, as well as produced the new type of, for example, carbonates by heating of the, our normal, how to say, compounds at high pressures and high temperatures, as we reported recently with Valerio Sarantola on examples of high pressure phases of the, produced by heating FeCO3. But this is just illustration. If somebody is interested, I can talk more about this. So my, last case for illustration are high energy density materials. And of course, when we are talking about high density energy materials, we are thinking about, first of all, of nitrides, coming back to the work by Mikhail Yeremets. I think it was also done here in geophysical lab when he discovered cubic gauge nitrogen with a single bond, which is supposed to be energetically very interesting material, towards the synthesis of a different nitrides, a polynitrides, which are maybe not only energetically interesting from an energetical point of view, but also from the point of view of incompressibility or even hardness. So, of course, the natural way how to produce the new nitrates is just load the metal, for example, iron, in nitrogen medium and heat it by laser. So what you can see here is iron in the diamond anvil cell compressed and, collected before heating and after laser heat. Of course, the interpretation of such diffraction pattern from the powder data would be hard work, okay? So we cannot immediately say what it is. But you see a lot of these spots, and this gives us not only hope, but also tool how to process this data. So we go more or less systematically through the different pressures and temperatures. We found that the pressure, for different pressure, in fact, we can synthesize the iron nitride with the B8 structure. It was in collaboration with a group from Dresden. We actually interested only in this material and very low pressure, but we continue to increase pressures and temperatures. At 50 GPa, we got the Fe3N2 material, which is isostructural to chromium carbide. interesting, but okay, nothing unusual. At pressure range above 50 GPa, we start to see formation of iron nitride with Markazite structure. This is already much more interesting, not only because we have much more nitrogen inside, but also because we see dinitride. We see that material become much less compressible, but still not as incompressible by titanium and iridium nitride. And in fact, we can easily explain this observation by comparison chemistry of these metals with FeN2 or with barium N2, calcium N2, and other compounds, which has an even lower compressibility. So here we have a cation with a 4+. For barium and cesium, barium and strontium and calcium, we have a 2+ charge of a cation. And here we have something intermediate, which corresponds to iron 3+. So this is Fe3. We consider this as Fe3+ and N2-3 minus anions. So we also can clearly note that there is anisotropic compression, and it's easily explained by the behavior of N2 anion. But most interesting observations came upon heating and pressure above 130 GPa. For me, it was especially interesting because this is, as far as I know, first example of the synthesis of a new compound and solution is structure at pressures above 100 GPa. But for our students did not appreciate this, but they appreciate that this is a just P1 bar symmetry, so it's triclinic material. We still have the data to parameter ratio above 6. Okay, there is not a great coverage, but it's enough data to fully solve and refine this structure to the R1 below 6%. What we see here is we see the formation of the change of the nitrogen with different distance between the nitrogens. So it means that we, in fact, have the polynitride with a certain complex organization of the chain. So in fact, this is not only such type of observation. Even the iron nitride was made much early than rhenium nitrides, which I'm talking about now. We were quite lucky to just realize that when simple heating of rhenium in nitrogen pressure medium at pressure around 130 GPa gives this quite open structure, which consists of the nitrogen change with the rhenium sitting on a very similar way as we see organization in the FeN4. But we also have a huge channels in which we can locate the residual of electronic density. And if we put it here, we find that there is a partially occupied by N2 molecules. So this is some kind of, if you wish, in analogy with the metal organic frameworks, it's metal inorganic frameworks formed at pressures above 100 GPa with the channels filled by the pressure medium. If you go to a higher pressure, to around 200 GPa, instead of FeN8XN2, we found the formation of rhenium N2 compound, which contain the also polymeric nitrogen change. But details of the distance distribution between this change and this change are significantly different. So this polynitride change are, how to say, alive, where changes are the function of the pressure. What is interesting in all this business, if we're talking about the high energy density materials, if we calculate the volume energetical density for FeNn4, it would be approximately 2.5 times higher than we know for the trinitrotoluol, TNT. And here it would be about 5 to 6 times higher. So it's really high energy density materials. Of course, that's a little bit high pressure for the application. But who knows, maybe the idea of a synthesis of such a compound may help to look for the much mild condition of the synthesis, like it, for example, happened with the cesium pentazolide, which was first discovered at a pressure around 40-50 GPa, and when synthesized, completely different road at ambient conditions. So just final slide. What we have at the moment? We have the ability to conduct the powder diffraction data or collect powder diffraction data at pressures exceeding the 300 GPa with different techniques, including the double anneal cells. We have a single crystal diffractions to over 200 GPa and thousands degree. Attract your possible interest to all this methodology, I would like to mention that it's probably not necessary to build all this complex setup. We now try to develop the diamond anvil with a round table. Here is a test of such a type of anvils at APS in your basically backyard. And this allow us to perform the high pressure, high temperature, single crystal diffraction experiments in situ without special setup. And we hope in the future to go to the light elements, to do simultaneous spectroscopy, time resolved, and so weiter, and so on. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Leonid, very much for your talk. So let's start the questions.
I can hear you.
So what, if you look at the data,
yes. This is a, actually what I mean. First of all, let us say, because idea of O23- is already on the in the air. It's already published by Chomsky group, Strelitzov and et al. So, and they basically put on the archive recently paper, I mean, same people, but without Chomsky, put the paper on the AFeO2H. So why we little bit suspicious about such arrangement? Two reasons, coming one from the experimental observations. What we got all the time, either using experimentally determined from powder diffraction data, too short OO distance, or when we try to optimize this, we also getting significantly shorter distance for O32- when we getting for the, our structural experimental results. From point of view of the theory or theoretical calculations, suggest that, in fact, when you either take experimental data or optimize with the DMFT calculations, you still have the significant difference, distance between the oxygen, and there is no direct interaction. But how to say, self-doping of by oxygen of conducting, but it's exactly what happens. It's half electrons. It's in fact going into the conducting band. That's what, as if I correctly reproduced explanation which I got from the theoretical colleagues, is happened with the, so it's not the totally or really free or one minus five, but from chemical point of view, you still can consider it as a reduced valence state of oxygen. Oh, sorry. Why I expect that you would like to see it? Yes. So where is some kind of, let's do it easier. I will put slide on the screen. It would be better to discuss. Yes. So, and I put all of them. Yes. So, how do I know that here is a hydrogen, you mean? Where are two things? Okay, you see only one series, we have a more. Up to around 300, 350 GPa, we still can measure Raman, Vibron of hydrogen. After this, well, it's. This is ambient. We unfortunately we have no expertise in low temperatures. High temperatures a little bit different, but this is ambient temperature. You mean data, nice data in science by data Silvera group. I mean, we can discuss it afterwards. I haven't seen what, I mean, what is contradict with Silvera groups is for sure. If you have such data, I do not know. I mean, I remember dark hydrogen by Grigorians, but okay, it's not as transparent as this pressure, but still I cannot quantify this. I still can see light. Okay.
What was the angle shape?
This is a double stage duct. So if this is what you see about 3 to 4 micron hole between two double stage anvils. The anvil itself is somewhere here. You cannot see the contrast.
What sound blot is it, like 10 microns?
This one? Yeah. No, this is less. This is about
but
4 micron. Yes. Yes. I mean, I put here just how to say. Illustration showing that there are different type of nitrogen interaction within this chain. If you want to see in more details, there are two options. We can talk with the scheme afterwards, or you can wait. It's within a week, there should be paper on Nature Communications where all this described in detail. If we do compression of different silica polymers in neon, I'm not aware, apart of made on the, are organized like a zeolite, but where, I mean, regular cristobalite, quartz, whatever, stishovite, it's even not necessary to consider it, coesite, we have absolutely no evidence that neon is actually incorporated. Gallium, maybe, that's why we did not use the gallium. But for neon, we do not have any evidence of incorporation. Especially this is true because we do not see any how to deviation from the behavior up to about 30-35 GPa. At high pressure, neon is already so hard that imaging diffusion inside the crystal structure at ambient temperature would be really something unusual. But again, as soon as we, I mean, neon, we have another examples where we can really see incorporation of neon when we're working with a metal organic network. It's worked by Ines Collins. And when we see this from the X-ray diffraction on the residual electronic density plots, we immediately see the density from the neon atoms. So if it will be anything, let's say, above fraction of a percent, we will see it immediately. Okay, it's more or less obvious when you analyze the high pressure data and you see the increase in the full width of half maximum of reflections, or you see bad errant, so it means that the reflections which are supposed to be equivalent become non-equivalent. You immediately know that something wrong with your data. In fact, something which I had to mention but forget. It's of course the significant improvement over what we had over the years when we start to load the single crystal and able to bring it to very high pressures. But it still has a certain limitation because the multiple phase transitions eventually destroyed your material. So we can go to probably megabar pressure range, but we never able to, let's say, compress Fe2O3 to above 80 GPa and still get a reasonable crystal structure. It's become too bad. Or Fe3O4, many other compounds. But what is important, that if we use the laser heating, basically at any pressure which we can reach and do the laser heating, we produce the quality of the crystallites which are sufficient for structural refining, solution and refining. Okay? Нет, это nice to meet you. I know you by at least by face. Oh. Yeah.
Very nice. Thank you. I just want to apologize. I'm not gonna be